Opinions expressed on this radio program do not necessarily reflect the views of this radio station.
My friends and I always tune into the Todd Levitt Law Show. Todd is entertaining, informative, and always delivers the goods.
Todd might not tell you what you want to hear, but he's going to tell you what you need to hear. And all you got to do is listen.
Hold on, Todd. Don't let go. It's time for the Todd L. Levitt Law Show.
Welcome to the Todd L. Levitt Marijuana Law Podcast. Good morning, good evening, and good night. I'm yours truly, attorney Todd L. Levitt, broadcasting and podcasting on a beautiful Labor Day weekend in the middle of the mitten, a beautiful green nutrient field in a Black Diamond Group mothership with my good friend Craig Russell, the muscle. No poem needed for Craig to know how much people love him. Craig, you're a loved man, brother.
Todd, you know I love hearing that. I even love hearing the corny poem, but I prefer not hearing it. But it's still nice to know. How you doing, brother? How you doing on this Labor Day weekend?
I'm doing great, and I'm going to be totally upfront with you and the listeners.
Okay.
We open the show today with Mad Season, River of Deceit.
Okay.
Mad Season, River of Deceit. Lane Staley of Alice in Chains got together with a couple outstanding musicians back in the day and formed Mad Season. River of Deceit is my number one all-time favorite song ahead of Lola.
Really?
Mad Season. It was just such a great collaboration. Oh, listen to Mad Season on YouTube or any platform where they play music. Lane Staley, in my opinion, his voice was second to none.
I knew I'd heard of him before, and I knew when you said Alice in Chains, I was like, okay, that's where I know him from, but I'd never heard of that band before. But really, that's your number one favorite song of all time, above everything else.
That and Temple of the Dog was also another top grunge era song, but Lane Staley's voice, it doesn't matter what he was singing or is singing. He's since passed on many years ago. He's my number one all-time favorite singer, and Mad Season was just a collaboration, and it was just outstanding. So on this Labor Day weekend, it's just a chillaxing, relaxing song. We have a lot of people who are right now, you know, driving along in the ditch, trying to get ahead of the Labor Day weekend rush home, which will take place tomorrow. And tomorrow, the Mackinac Bridge will be shut down as they do the yearly walk across the Mackinac Bridge. I've never done that. Have you ever done that?
I've actually been in Mackinac City and had family members do it, but I didn't do it. No, I'm not walking the 5 miles. I don't even like driving across that bridge, let alone walking across it. Not a chance. But like I said, Ben, it's a fun place to be. And you want to talk about, if you ever want to see a place clear out, do that. Go up to Mackinac City on the Monday morning for the bridge walk. There's hundreds of thousands of people. By about 3 o'clock in the afternoon, Mackinac City is a ghost town. You literally can run up and down the streets, in the middle of the streets, and you won't see anybody for hours. It clears out that quick. But it's a fun time. It's fun being there.
Something we can all relate to is being stuck in traffic. Last week, I was driving along the ditch, as I like to call the highways and byways, and I was on my way back north, and I was coming north of Lansing on 127, and as soon as I hit St. John's, there was a traffic jam from St. John's on 127 all the way to Ithaca, where the traffic turns back into a faster highway at 75. Right. I believe it's 75 miles an hour now. Yep. I have to check on that.
No, it is.
But I was in the lane going north. It was south that was backed up for about 7 miles. And I got to be honest with you, Craig. We've all been there. We've all been stuck in traffic. And I felt pretty good because I was not at that point stuck in traffic. And but we've all been there. And I just rolled my window down, put my hand out. I didn't wave. I wasn't rude. But, man, it did feel good because we know that feeling. Am I right? Man. Do you know that feeling?
Oh, totally. You remember 27 before they built the extension around St. John's when you had to actually go through St. John's? You want to talk about traffic backups on a holiday weekend. That thing was murder. Just the worst. But, you know, now the highway goes mostly around.
Oh, yeah. You had to go through DeWitt.
Yeah. Well, and not only that part, but you had to go through St. John's, right through the heart of St. John's. That would get so backed up in that area there. At least now the highway, you can go around that and it's not so bad. But I remember when the highway, before they even built 69 from Lansing to Marshall in that area, where it was all just it was four lane road, not highway, that got backed up as well too. At least they built that. I wonder if they're ever going to connect that little stretch there between Ithaca and north of St. John's, where it's like 11 or 12 miles where it's 65 through there. I wonder if they're ever going to make that a full four lane highway and just
leave it the way it is. It's fine. I'm okay with the way it is. But so I'm on my way back. The traffic is backed up on the other side of the road heading south. I get back to Mount Pleasant, Michigan, and I stop off at, I'll say the name, at Walmart, and I had to purchase something.
Uh-oh.
I'm in the checkout line, Craig, and my bill came to, I think it was something like, $4.99, something with a 99 cent on it. So I gave the cashier, if it was like $9.99 or $4.99, I gave the cashier, I can't recall, a $5 or a $10 or $20 bill. And Walmart owed me a penny, and I was not allowed. I wasn't going to let Walmart take my penny. I'm sorry. Walmart's a billion-dollar corporation.
Yeah.
And there were people behind me, and they were looking at me like, are you serious? I mean, I could tell the look in the lady's face behind me. And I turned and looked at her and said, hey, I'm not giving Walmart my penny. And the cashier didn't have any pennies and had to actually go and get, like a roll of pennies and then
sure.
open it up into the drawer before
sure.
I got my penny. So I bet I not only was traffic backed up going south, but I ended up causing a backup at the Walmart checkout line because I'll be damned if I'm going to give Walmart or any business my penny.
I would give some businesses that penny, but not Walmart. Walmart needs to give me my penny back. But I agree with you on that one. I would totally.
Yeah, I'd give a mom and pop business.
Yeah.
I've given pennies, nickels, dimes. I've even bought and purchased, ice cream for people that have been in line, or Slurpees, or you pass it on. But that big corporation was not getting my penny. I'm just here to say, they're not getting it. There's no way. I'm just saying. And people were not happy with me. But you know what? I don't really care. You know what I found out, Craig?
What?
I found out, and this is a fact, and it's really a sad fact. This is just completely BS. When I'm wearing a suit, and I got some really nice suits. I wear these black, shiny wedding shoes.
Sure.
I'm an attorney, and I look like an attorney. I don't know what that means. I mean, attorneys come in all sizes, shapes, and forms.
You got to go to court.
But
you got to look good. I agree. Yeah, I get it.
Yeah, I mean, I'm 6 feet tall, dark hair, 220, got a full head of hair. It's always, you know, Italian slicked back. Look at me talking like that now. But I find that when I'm in a suit, people treat me completely different.
Oh, yeah.
As opposed to when I'm not in a suit. Because a couple of weeks back, I was out of town somewhere. I didn't shave for 3 days. My hair was a mess. I had a t-shirt on and some shorts and whatnot. I walked into a business, and I just found it really interesting how this lady, who was just, you know, an hourly paid worker, how she was treating me and the things she was saying to me. Had I walked in there in one of my gray or black suits, all, you know, dabbed out, there's no way in heck this lady would have said or said the things to me the way she did or act the way she did. And that's really sad because, you know, nobody should discriminate against anybody in any business just because of the way they're dressed.
Well, you know, ZZ Top said it best, man. Every girl's crazy about a sharp-dressed man. It's the truth, though. People treat you differently based on...
It really is the truth.
It's completely the truth. Yeah, it is. Not only based on what you're wearing, but even what you look like. Because, you know, there are days, I was on vacation a few days a couple weeks ago, and I didn't shave, and you're right. You get different looks than if you're, you know, dressed up, even to the nines, even if you just look more business-like than, you know, say, a t-shirt and a pair of shorts or something like that. Unfortunately, that's where we are as a society.
I found when I worked at a clothing store in high school at Oakland Mall at Merry-Go-Round back, and I think I was there from like 80 to 83 when I graduated Berkeley High in 1983. You have no idea who's why, and we worked on commission. And, you know, there would be individuals who would walk in and they weren't dressed up. And these people would pull out their wallets and spend, you know, $400 or $500. Same yep. thing when I delivered pizzas for Domino's at the same time. I was delivering pizzas all over Hazel Park, Madison Heights. The best tippers were the men and women who were from Madison Heights, who were from Hazel Park, who were the automotive workers, the yep. hard blue collar yep. men and women who knew what it was like to have, you know, to deliver pizzas like I was delivering pizzas. And so there were times where I had to go to other stores in Farmington Hills or Birmingham, and those people didn't, you know, tip worth a crap. So, you know, you cannot ever judge an individual by what he or she is wearing or what they look like because, you know, you just can't do it. And those people who are the automotive workers in those cities, those blue-collar cities, Ferndale, Royal Oak, Hazel Park, Madison Heights, you know, Berkeley, they were the best tippers ever because they understood it.
And it doesn't really matter what part of the country you're in. We're talking about Michigan, but, you know, depending on where you're listening on the podcast or if you are listening on 98.5 and you're maybe from another part of the state or another part, you know, maybe from Chicago or something like that, that you know the areas in your town that are the exact same way. There's some places where there's the blue-collar people, and they're the ones who get it, and then there's the ones... See, I delivered pizza, too. So whenever I get a pizza delivery, I always tip well because I know what those people have to go through. It's the same thing. Doesn't matter where you're from. People are basically the same, and cities are set up the same. There's the good parts of the area and the bad parts where they don't tip well and the places where they do tip well. But, hey, guess what, Todd?
What's that, Craig? We're a law show.
We're a law show. That's right. We've got to get to a law to talk about. What are we talking about?
Well, it's Labor Day weekend, so I thought we'd talk about marijuana. What do you think about that?
And
I got some advice from Attorney Steve Lato. So big shout out to Attorney Steve Lato. Yeah, we had a discussion last week about an issue that came up. So we're definitely going to talk to the listeners about that, and everybody will relate to it. And then we have some marijuana laws, and I want to talk about legalization and a federal prohibition, and where do Native American tribes fit into that. So we'll talk about that when we come back from break on this Labor Day weekend on the show of all shows.
The Todd L. Levitt Law Show thanks you for listening to our podcast. If you have a business you think people would want to hear about, the Todd L. Levitt Law Show accepts advertising. We can promote your business to a very specialized, targeted audience. Any size commitment and any budget. Email toddlevittlawshow@gmail.com for more information about sponsoring and advertising on the Todd L. Levitt Law Show podcast. Thank you.
Welcome back to the Todd L. Levitt Law Show, broadcasting and podcasting in a beautiful green nutrient field on this Labor Day weekend, 2019, with my good friend Craig Russell. The water is wet, the sky is blue, and all the listeners, including me, we love you, Craig. We do.
Oh, Todd, that's so sweet, you silly son of a...
That is so corny.
It is really corny, but that's okay. I think people expect that from
the show. That's okay.
That's what they expect. It's Labor Day weekend. You know what is great about Labor Day weekend? Because some other holidays that we celebrate, things like Easter or even Memorial Day, they're a little more somber, they're a little more serious. Labor Day weekend just celebrates the salt of the earth, the hardworking men and women of America. This is, you can actually say Happy Labor Day, and that's okay, because most people don't have to work on Labor Day, which is good. And the people who do have to work, we appreciate it. But Labor Day is one of those ones you can say Happy Labor Day or have a happy, safe holiday weekend, and you're not offending anyone. If you say Happy Memorial Day, that sounds weird. Happy Veterans Day or, you know, Happy Remembrance Day, it doesn't sound right, but Happy Labor Day works.
I totally understand that. And by the way, we were talking about, not to deviate, the fact that I would not allow Walmart to have my penny.
Yes.
Well, during the break, you and I talked about that, and you agree with me 100% on that, correct?
Oh, yeah.
I love Walmart. We're not knocking Walmart. I love Walmart. I go there all the time. Who doesn't love? I mean, I'm into, you know, dollar stores now, but I'll still go to Walmart.
But you know what, though? Sometimes you can get better deals at Walmart than you can at the dollar store. Some things that are a dollar at the dollar store are 94 cents at Walmart. You get a better deal. So there's that.
It all comes down to buying power. See, how it works is with these big dollar stores and Walmart and these big box stores, they have such strong buying power they can manipulate and in some cases bully salespeople who are representing products into lowering the margins. So, I mean, you got a choice. Do you want to get your product in 10 stores across the country and sell it for $20 an item? Or do you want to get it in 1,000 Walmarts across the country and lower the cost to about $4.99. So your margins are way down, but you know, Walmart, you know, if you want to sell your product in a Walmart or these other dollar stores, you're definitely going to have to come way down on your cost and what you're willing to sell your product to the distribution company that's going to place it into Walmart. Or I'm not sure if products just sell directly to Walmart, but we talked about this before in Bentonville, Arkansas. There's a lot of companies that set up shop right down the road from the headquarters so that they can stay in touch with the men and women who oversee all the purchasing for big Walmart. So, and Sam's Club, and et cetera, et cetera.
And there was they had a documentary on CNBC probably 5 or 6 years ago talking about that. And they have these big, they'll go to these hotel conference rooms and they'll have these big, basically their product pitches. You bring in your product and you want to sell it to Walmart, and Walmart says, cost you 85 cents to make that. We want to buy it for, you know, $1.20. You need to make it for 60 cents. And if you can't get it lower, they won't buy it. And if you have to figure out a way to make it cheaper so they can buy it and sell it cheaper. But it's you get this quantity. You're going to sell hundreds of thousands as opposed to 10,000. And if you can lower the price, you're still going to get, you're going to make more money off of it. And of course, being in Walmart, I mean, you know, the only products that make it into Walmart are ones that are going to sell. That's what they do. But we're not a business show, Todd. We're a law show. Let's talk about the law.
We are a law show. So here's some advice from attorney Steve Leto, who is one of the top lemon consumer lawyers in the country. Our good friend Steve Leto. If you're going to, because this issue has come up in my law practice over the years, time and time again, if you're an individual out there and you're going to sell a car to somebody,
make sure you go to the Department of State or Secretary of State, Department of Motor Vehicle in the state in which you live in, and make sure that the person you're selling the vehicle to actually transfers the title out of your name into their name. I cannot tell you and the listeners, Craig, how often over the last 26 years, I'm a criminal defense lawyer, but I get these calls. Todd, I sold my vehicle to person A. Person A never transferred the title into his or her name. They ended up selling it to a third party. Now that third party never transferred the vehicle, you know, into their name, the title, and there was an accident that was involved. And now they're suing me. Well, guess what, folks? Under that scenario, you are 100% liable for any and everything that happens in regards to that vehicle, because you basically still own it. The title never got transferred out of your name. Now, as an attorney, if I was a civil attorney and I was defending you or through the insurance company, I would ask you, do you have a bill of sale? Do you have anything in text or email messages that indicates, or any witnesses, that you actually sold it to this party, you know, who then transferred it to the other party? So the best advice I can give you, and this also comes from attorney Steve Lato, go with the person and make sure the title gets transferred.
So I actually had that happen to me, Todd. I can throw that out there. A few years ago, I bought a $500 1990 Toyota Corolla off of Craigslist. If that tells you how long ago this was. And I sold it to a guy for $375.
Congratulations on Craigslist, by the way.
Yeah, you know, it's been a great source of not income for me at all. But so I sold this car to this guy for $375. And come to find out about 6 months later, I was living in Grand Rapids at the time. About 6 months later, I get this notice in the mail that the car has been parked for like 6 weeks and they're going to impound it. And if they can't do anything with it and they have to crush it or whatever, I'm going to get charged for it. And I'm like, why am I getting this about this car? Oh, yeah, because all I did was take the money. The guy just took it. He abandoned the car a couple of weeks later. I mean, it was just a piece of crap. It had 400,000 miles on it. It had holes in the floorboards and everything. It was a terrible car. It got me point A to point B for about 6 months till I could get a different car. But the guy just abandoned it somewhere. And so the city picked it up. They crushed it into a little box. And I guess they kept the money or something for it. But that's exactly correct. Luckily, nothing bad happened. But what Steve Lato is saying is the honest to God truth. And what you're saying as well, you've got to make sure those people transfer that car into their names out of your name so you don't become liable for something, because that could be terrible.
Especially with everyone buying and selling everything on the internet now, you know, so that, yeah, it can be really risky, because if somebody apparently purchases your vehicle and never transfers a title into their name and they go out and get in a serious accident, you know, you're liable for that, and you could be liable for that. So that's some serious stuff.
So let me ask you this, Todd. If you, like you were talking about a few minutes ago, if you would go through and want to check somebody's text or see if you have a bill of sale or something like that, will that make any kind of a difference at all? If, let's say, you did sell your car to somebody and they didn't transfer it over and they get into an accident, and you can then go and say, look, I sold this car. Here's the deal. Here's the cash I got. I deposited it into the bank. Here's the day I deposited it. It's the day that the bill of sale is written up. You know what I mean? I mean, can that make a difference, or are you just going to really be screwed no matter what?
Yes and no. And it's up to the, you know, the plaintiff's attorney. You know, whenever somebody's suing somebody, they're going after deep pockets. So if you carry an insurance policy and the person you sold the vehicle to never insured the vehicle and has no assets, and yet you're carrying a couple $100,000 policy on that vehicle and someone was seriously injured, if I'm a plaintiff's attorney, I'm not letting you out of that lawsuit. I'm going to, you know, keep pressing and pressing and grinding away until we get a recovery for our client. So, I mean, the bottom line is, if you're going to sell anything and it involves a title, make sure the title actually gets transferred. It's just smart common sense.
Yeah, but you know, sometimes people don't have a lot of common sense when it comes to that kind of stuff. But I mean, it was me, when I had the car, I sold it and I canceled the insurance on it that day. So if that guy would have gotten to an accident a couple weeks later, there would have been no insurance on it if he didn't put any insurance on it. And since he didn't transfer it to his name, I doubt he did. What would happen then?
That's a bad move. That's a bad move by you, Craig.
Oh, it was. It was a total bad move. Luckily, nothing bad happened, and I learned my lesson from it. But you don't always get those opportunities to learn lessons where nothing bad happens. So, yeah, no, I get it.
Yeah, I wouldn't transfer, and I would not uninsure that vehicle until you're absolutely assured that the person you sold the vehicle to is covering that vehicle and has the title transferred out of your name. It's, again, it will save you a lot of heartache and financial ache down the road. You know, having a civil lawsuit, somebody come after you, it's not a pleasant experience, with depositions and, you know, uncertainty as to what the outcome could or could not be. So you definitely need to make sure you take steps to avoid that.
Luckily, I learned my lesson. I didn't get nothing bad happened to me, but, you know, take my experience and learn from it as well. Make sure you take care of that. You were going to talk about some marijuana law. Is that correct, Todd?
Yeah, I mean, I wanted to talk about, you know, tribes, Michigan tribes. There's Native American tribes all over the country. And with the end of federal prohibition against cannabis on the horizon, how is that currently affecting tribes now and in the future? And I know we have to go to break here in a minute, but just to refresh everybody's memories, because we get a lot of people listening to the podcast from all over the world and in other states in this great country of ours. We love our country. On November 6th of 2018, in the great state of Michigan where we broadcast from, Michigan became, as you know, Craig, and we always talk about it, the first state in the Midwest to legalize the recreational use of marijuana. And that was through the, and Scott Roberts has mentioned this too, the Michigan Regulation Taxation of Marijuana Act, which basically decriminalizes the, you know, personal possession and cultivation of marijuana by adults 21 years of age or older. And that includes, you know, commercial grows, operations, distributions, retail sales, provisioning centers, as we always talk about, and more. But the law is silent regarding Michigan federally recognized tribes. And this is an issue that tribes have been wrestling with for some time. If you think about it, I think statistically, in 2017, marijuana sales in the U.S. reached $9.2 billion and are on track to reach $24.5 billion by 2021. And American tribes, in most cases, are left out of this, which is really, you know, wrong, because tribes are, you know, they have their own jurisdiction to govern themselves as sovereign nation, but there's still federal jurisdiction over these tribes. And since marijuana is still a Schedule I drug under the Controlled Substance Act, it has literally prevented most tribes from entering into the cannabis market. And, you know, there's been some gains in that area that I want to talk about when we come back from break. But in the past, they've been shut down by the federal government, and it's wrong on every level.
And we will get to all that, but we do have to take a break here right on the Todd L. Levitt Law Show. We will be right back and talk more about that. The Todd L. Levitt Law Show thanks you for listening to our podcast. If you have a business you think people would want to hear about, the Todd L. Levitt Law Show accepts advertising. We can promote your business to a very specialized, targeted audience. Any size commitment and any budget. Email toddlevittlawshow@gmail.com for more information about sponsoring and advertising on the Todd L. Levitt Law Show podcast.
Oh,
Welcome back to the Todd L. Levitt Law Show on this beautiful Labor Day weekend, broadcasting and podcasting. By the way, Craig, in a beautiful green nutrient field, a legal recreational field, seeing that Michigan was the first state in the Midwest to recreationalize cannabis, we are just loving this field today. It's clones, clones, and clones.
And it's been a beautiful weekend so far, especially the farther north you go. And we're leading into, did you see the old Farmer's Almanac says we're going to have a harder winter? It's going to start really early and go really late again. Come on. I hate that thing. Hate it.
Yeah, not a fan. Not a fan of long winters and daylight savings time. But hey, we're talking about cannabis and Native American tribes.
Right.
And in South Dakota, the Sioux tribe had planned to open up, and you have mentioned this, I think, on a previous show, the nation's first marijuana resort that would have included a lounge where, you know, customers can use the tribal grown products, and the tribe in the Dakotas built a facility. They planted crops and began converting existing buildings into a lounge. But unfortunately, South Dakota is one of those states where, you know, it was still illegal under state law. And even though the tribe attempted, Craig, to resolve the jurisdictional issues with non-tribal authorities, like the Department of Justice came in and warned of a raid if the tribe, persisted. And eventually the tribe suspended the project. And this is horrible. Had to burn all the crops. And in California, there were a number of tribes that faced similar problems. And again, the issue is that you have all these non-tribal members in all these states around the country where marijuana is now legal, and non-tribal members, as they surround these sovereign nations, you know, can participate and have immunity from prosecution. Yet on tribal lands, because of federal oversight and the Department of Justice, you know, they are not moving forward as fast as you would think they would. And it's unfortunate, and it's not fair. I mean, can you imagine how unfair that is? I can't even get into all the issues, but there's plenty of them. But, back in the day, not too far back, there were a number of memos from the Department of Justice, the Cole Wilkinson memos, as we talk about on various past shows, Craig, in regards to the Department of Justice and their policy positions in regards to coming into sovereign states and enforcing federal laws, as long as the states and local jurisdictions do what they do to enforce all the state drug laws and some of the federal oversight in conjunction with the feds, then the feds aren't going to come into the states. So in regards to these tribes that were attempting early on to plan these big marijuana resorts, especially in states that weren't even recreational or medical, the tribes ran smack dab into the Department of Justice policies. So that's what the issue was. But there have been a number of successes. And where there has been success, for instance, the tribes in the state of Washington were among the first to confront this dilemma of state legalized marijuana as Washington, the state itself moved towards that direction. You know, they were faced with how to enforce their laws against not only tribal members, but not Indians. And so what the tribes in the state of Washington did, they approached it the right way. They worked within, you know, the government on a state level to form a compact, Craig, to work with the state, to figure out the tax structure, the law enforcement structure, and work together to find this clear understanding of how tribes can move forward and participate legally and not, you know, not get in conflict with the federal laws and the Department of Justice. And so in Washington, they've been very successful. And Nevada followed, I think it was 2017, if my memory is correct. Nevada tribes followed Washington's lead, and they were able to get legislation passed providing for state tribal compacts. So there's something called a compact where the tribes work with state government and the Department of Justice, and they work out all these issues. They work out enforcement issues, legality issues, health issues, all the issues, taxation issues. So when you have these tribes in states where it's recreational and or medical that are working with the local government, the state government, the governor's office, and the federal government, then things work in their favor. You know, I think in Michigan, we have, I think, and I could be wrong, 12 recognized tribes. Does that sound correct, Craig?
That sounds about right, yeah.
So, yeah, there are currently 12 federally recognized tribes in the state of Michigan. And there are actually other bands that are applying for recognition, and I hope they get it as well. So, but most tribes, most tribal laws, they have each of these tribes do have laws that govern most civil and misdemeanor cases on their sovereign nations, Craig. But as I said, time and time again, the federal government and federal law still governs in other circumstances. And that's where the issue and the conflict has come into being. You know, you have all these states, as I just said, going recreational and medical, but these sovereign nations are stuck with federal oversight, and they've had some difficulty. But as we said, in Washington and Nevada, you have the tribes working with the government and the federal government to form these compacts, and they're able to move forward with marijuana and other cannabis-related products. Wasn't there a tribe up in the UP, up in the Sioux, that also passed certain laws within their nation to allow for cannabis? I thought we talked about that a number of weeks back. I believe there is one or two now in the Upper Peninsula that have and are allowing cannabis on their nation land.
Yes, it's the ones that run not only the like the casinos in Brimley, but the ones the Quaden casinos. They're the tribe behind that are the ones who they've both.
But do you see the hypocrisy?
Oh,
I mean, how can it be? What Native Americans, with all their amazing traditions and their beautiful culture and everything that goes back, you know, thousands and thousands, who knows how many years in regards to their ceremonies and whatnot, that they are left out because of the fact that our men and women in Congress can't get off their you know what's and remove cannabis from Schedule 1 of the Controlled Substance Act. I mean, it's hypocrisy. It's nuts.
And of course, as we talk about it, and I sound like a broken record every time I say it, because finally the federal government will start to realize that they can make money off of this. What do you know about that? If it's $24 billion by 2021 and you start including Indian reservations and Native American tribes who are able to cultivate, sell, and make profit off their own product to their own people, guess what? Since it's federal and the government has oversight over these reservations, they're going to be able to tax it and they'll be able to make some money off of it. Everything revolves around money, as always. What I don't understand is in some parts of the country where you've got a clash between states where everything is legal. Here's a great example. Colorado, Nevada, and South Dakota. Now, in Colorado, of course, recreational and medical marijuana have been around for a while. Nevada or Nebraska, it is completely not legal. Same thing in South Dakota. Matter of fact, in South Dakota, the governor there is treating the whole situation, you know, she isn't even letting hemp become legalized, even though it is legalized federally. She doesn't even want to let commercial hemp production happen because she believes that it's going to turn into a reefer madness situation, that everyone's going to get high off the hemp and everything. It's interesting how close these states are together, yet how completely far apart they are on some of these issues. And of course, who is stuck in the middle of all of it? Well, that would be the Native Americans, because in Colorado, Native Americans obviously not only can participate in legal marijuana and recreational marijuana, but the Indian tribes can. Well, and that was one of the things you brought up. All those states where they've come up with these compacts with the Native American tribes and with the state are states where it is legal. And the states that don't have that are the states where it isn't legal. It's just interesting to see how close these states are to each other, yet are so far apart in some of the thinking on some of this stuff. It doesn't make any sense. And again, once they figure out that they all make money off of it, then things will change. That's how it always works.
It's all about money.
All about the cash.
You got it. Hey, Craig, I believe we have to go to break. Is that right?
We do have to take a break, yep. But when we come back,
I will have another complaint.
Get out of here. Stop. You're kidding.
No, it's true. No, I'm not. It's true.
It's true. All right, we'll come back with one more Todd complaint on the Todd Levitt Law Show, the Labor Day edition, when we come back. The Todd L. Levitt Law Show thanks you for listening to our podcast. If you have a business you think people would want to hear about, the Todd L. Levitt Law Show accepts advertising. We can promote your business to a very specialized, targeted audience. Any size commitment and any budget. Email toddlevittlawshow@gmail.com for more information about sponsoring and advertising on the Todd L. Levitt Law Show podcast.
Welcome back to the Todd L. Levitt Law Show. Coming back strong with Mad Season, Lane Staley, one of my number one, literally. This goes out to Gavin out there. Gavin and Big Hair, they always ask me about, come on, is Quiet Riot, were they really in your top 10? Def Leppard, Pink Floyd, love Pink Floyd. But Mad Season was Lane Staley from Alice in Chains, one of the members of Pearl Jam. And I can't recall the name of the other individual or individuals who are just outstanding musicians. And they came out with this album, Mad Season, in the early 1990s, I believe. And it was just unreal. Lane Staley has just the greatest voice, that sound gruff of the 90s music, the grunge music. I love that guy.
To keep track, you actually have 53 groups in your top 10. Just telling you, all the groups that are in your top 10.
Mad Season's at the top. I'm telling you right now, Mad Season, Pink Floyd, Metallica, Black Sabbath. You can't go wrong with Black Sabbath. And there's some really hardcore groups in there.
Kinks?
As well.
What about the Kinks?
I need to break it into categories.
Yeah, you do.
Love the Kinks, Lola, classic rock. I need to break it down. People keep asking me what happened to the 1980s dance party. I'm not really sure. It got pushed aside for the grunge. So just like anything else in the 80s, we were going to have a 1980s dance party. And then, you know, I rediscovered Mad Season and grunge, and I'm no longer in the mood to throw a 1980s dance party, Craig. We wanted to bring back slow dancing because the kids today, they don't slow dance like you and I did. I'm 54, you're 88. We used to slow dance when we were growing up. And, you know, Stairway to Heaven, you had 15 minutes there to, get the job done, you know, make a connection with that young lady. But, yeah, they don't slow dance anymore.
Just to be specific, you and I didn't slow dance together. Back in the 80s, we slow danced with young ladies.
No, that would never have happened. That would never have happened.
Not 2019.
Yeah, respectfully with the young ladies.
Yes, exactly.
Very respectful, you know.
Yes.
Yeah. You know, at a distance, you know, that stiff slow dance. Yeah, it was a stiff, arm's length slow dance.
Hey,
speaking of the 80s, Top Gun's coming out again.
That's right. The new Top Gun Maverick movie is going to be out soon. They had
Can't wait.
Getting a trailer for it. Kelly Preston's not going to be in that, though. It's really weird how they didn't ask her to be in that.
I'm okay with that. I'm okay with that. Yeah.
Hey, you had a complaint. We're going to wrap the show up with one more Todd L. Levitt famous complaint. What's your complaint?
Well, we have a lot of folks out there who are listening to the show. At least we hope so. All 20 listeners, and most of them are Amish and a few family members. A couple friends, little John. We love little John. He always listens to the show. But and everyone's traveling back today and tomorrow, Labor Day weekend here. So we want everyone to be safe. Wear your seatbelt. Don't be distracted as you're driving. My complaint is that when I have to get up in the morning really early and go somewhere in regards to court that may be outside of my local jurisdiction, so I'm getting up and leaving at 6:30, 7 o'clock, I just find that there's a lot of people who are angry drivers. You know, they just you get three or four vehicles behind you just passing you and speeding and in such a rush. It's really stressful to leave to go to work at 6:30, 7 o'clock when all these other people are leaving and they're obviously running late because people are just driving like crazy at that time of the morning.
I'll tell you this much, man. If you think getting up and leaving at 6:30 and 7 is early, try and get up and leaving at 4:30 and 5 like some of us who work early. You don't get angry drivers then. You get no drivers. You get to run the road. Do whatever you want.
I'm not driving like a turtle. I mean, I'm pushing it. I'm not going to say here on the radio and in front of all of our 20 listeners that I'm speeding. But again, I'm in a truck and I'm moving at a good clip. And apparently it's not fast enough. I mean, when I wake up in the morning, I'm just waking up. I'm chillaxed. I'm drinking maybe some coffee. And this time of the year, pumpkin spice, which I can't get enough of pumpkin spice. I've got pumpkin spice cereal and toothpaste and beverages. Even my fish are now, ingesting pumpkin spice fish food. They're addicted to it. I'm everything pumpkin spice right now, Craig. Yogurt and ketchup and mustard. I'm joking with that, but
Todd,
it's pumpkin spice time of the year once again.
Todd, it is September 2nd. Come on. It's not even, the leaves haven't even started to change. Even in the UP, the leaves haven't started to change yet. It's not fall yet.
Have you been to the store lately? Pumpkin spice is on the market and full blown effect, my man.
Everywhere. No, but it's like it's not even, football's barely started. The NFL starts this week. It hasn't even gotten to be football season yet. Jeez. But fire up chips. Fire up chips who played on Thursday night. Woohoo.
Go blue, go green.
There we go. Hey, I hate to break things to
you. Go, Craig.
We got to go. We got to get out of here.
We got to go. It's Labor Day weekend. Well, everybody out there, I'm attorney Todd L. Levitt, Mile Plus, Michigan's very own criminal defense licensed restoration lawyer in the mothership with my good friend Craig Russell, the muscle, wishing everybody out there a happy, healthy Labor Day weekend, safe driving. We'll see you same time, same place next week. You can catch us on all the different podcast platforms, Craig, Spotify, SoundCloud, iTunes. Make sure you download the WUPS app and you can listen 24 hours a day to 98.5 UPS and all the other Black Diamond Group stations. But Craig, I'm not just a litigator. I'm an advocator. Take us out with some Lane Staley, Mad Season. Love it. See you next week.
My pain is self-chosen. At least I believe it to be. I could either drown or pull up.
Todd L. Levitt Law Show, brought to you by Chad Malleywell Drilling of Rosebush, Clark Modular Homes, your most experienced and trusted builder in Mount Pleasant, Clear Vision Windows, Siding, Roofing, and Attic Insulation of Midland, Mackinac Properties and Northern Michigan Vacation Rentals, buying, selling, and renting properties in the Straits of Mackinac region since 1998, Tim's Collision Plus in Roscommon, Harrison Power Sports, Central Michigan's fastest growing full-line Arctic Cat dealer, and Dr. Robert Townsend in Denali Healthcare for your alternative healthcare needs.
Opinions expressed on this radio program do not necessarily reflect the views of this radio station.